Friend from Arkansas. Director Brennan, do you know who commissioned the Steele dossier?
I don't.
Do you know if the FBI paid for any portion of the Steele dossier?
I don't know. I know that there are press reports related to that, but I don't know. I have no firsthand knowledge of that.
Do you know whether any of the underlying allegations made in the Steele dossier were ever tested, probed, examined, cross-examined, whether the sources were examined for reliability, credibility?
I know that there were efforts made by the Bureau to try to understand whether or not any of the information in that was I don't have any firsthand knowledge of it.
Do you know if the Bureau ever relied on the Steele dossier as part of any court filings, applications, petitions, pleadings?
I have no awareness.
Did the CIA rely on it?
No.
Why not?
Because we didn't. It wasn't part of the corpus of intelligence information that we had. It was not in any way used as a basis for the intelligence community assessment that was done. It was not.
All right. This is my last line of question. I hope I have waited sufficiently long enough to ask you about leaks to not inflame the anger of our friends in the media who think Republicans are hyper-focused on it. So we'll just do it last. Some of your colleagues have testified that our surveillance programs are critical, vital, indispensable to our national security. Do you agree with their assessment?
Speaking generally, yes, some of those programs are absolutely essential and vital to our national security.
Do you agree that there is at least a tacit agreement between the American people and their government that they will allow us certain power, certain freedoms in exchange for safeguarding the privacy of the information collected?
I think there is certainly an expectation that there would be a protection of privacy as the government carries out its responsibilities, yes.
And you and I discussed some of those privacy protections, even within the intelligence community, as it relates to U.S. persons. And you've been very clear this morning. In fact, I've noted the times you've said U.S. persons. You could have inserted a name, but you did not. You had the discipline to say U.S. person. And that discipline is practiced throughout the intelligence community unless and until there is a request to unmask that U.S. person's name, correct?
I would like to think that discipline is still exercised even if a request to unmask a name is made.
All right. So we protect U.S. persons even within those like yourself and Director Pompeo and Admiral Rogers and Director Comey and the people that we trust with awesome powers, we still impose some restrictions on them and that they have to request an unmasking. There has to be, I assume, a justification. You can't just wake up in the morning and say, hey, I feel like knowing who participated in X, Y, and Z, there has to be justification, right?
Yes.
All right. So how do we get from that to names being on the front pages of certain major U.S. newspapers?
It's an excellent question.
What would be an equally excellent answer?
That somebody violated their oath to protect classified information and violated that oath and shared that information in an unauthorized fashion with members of the media.
Well, my friend from Washington, and he is my friend, I was impressed not only with his eloquence, but the conviction with which he just spoke. But I've got other colleagues, not from Washington, that tend to minimize the nature of leaks as if there is somehow a weighing and a balancing that needs to take place between how interesting we may find the underlying information, how interesting we may find the underlying names. I have seen attempts, unfortunately, by members of this very body to mitigate and explain away and minimize what it does to the surveillance programs to have leaks of classified information. So I will finish with this. I believe there's some surveillance programs that are up for reauthorization. What would you say to American people as names are unmasked on the last day that people are in office and classified information appears on the front pages of major U.S. newspapers, how would you tell your constituents, let's reauthorize this program again despite the fact that we have abuses? Help us make that argument when we go home.
Mr. Gowdy, you and your colleagues here are going to have to make that argument based on the merits of the program and the importance of it to our national security, as well as trying to send a reassuring message to them that if there have been any abuses of the accesses to that information, either because of the number of people involved or those who were, in fact, violating their oath of office, that you and your colleagues will do everything possible to make sure you work with the executive branch to minimize and mitigate that danger.